Methodist Church. Isn't it good to be in the house of God on Sunday mornings? I was associate preacher for a while down in Savannah, Georgia, and the senior pastor there, Jim Giddens, liked to say that you might be here today not for yourself, but for the person sitting on your right or left or in front of you or behind you. He would say that you're here to pick other people up, not just to be ministered to, but to minister to other people. And I know you all know that. I saw you visiting and hugging and well, maybe not so much hugging, but visiting before church. And I think it's a blessing for us to be here gathered in person and a blessing to have all of you joining us on the internet as we join together. Our call to worship is from Psalm 118. Let's stand, please. I'll read the dark print if you all read the dark print. This is the day which the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
For his mercy endureth forever.
Amen. Let us pray together. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. And as you are standing, if you would kindly join us as we sing Amazing Grace. Please recite with us the Apostles' Creed. Let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Oh,
two or three people, somebody that has a different last name.
Good morning. As I usually say, God is good and all the time. Okay, this is the first of the month, so birthdays. Who has a birthday in the month of May? Anybody?
You do.
I do. So if nobody else has a birthday, we'll sing a birthday. You have a birthday. All right.
There we go.
All right. Well, we got several birthday members. Let's see. I think it's somewhere I had a list of who all had the birthdays. But anyhow, if you're here and you had a birthday, stand up and we'll sing you a birthday song, okay?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
And as we say, many more. Anniversaries. Anybody have an anniversary? Look back there. Pastor?
That's right.
Lori and I. Lori? And Rusty? And Bruce? Okay. Well, years. What kind of year thing do we have? I know you don't quote Rusty for the oldest year, so you can just go ahead and sit down. How many, Laura?
37.
Congratulations to our pastor, 37. Now, before I say anything else, you gonna say something? Come on up here.
Good morning. United Methodist Men decided this last week that we're going to do a butt sale, a Boston butt sale, for Memorial Day. And because I presented this to them in a way that they couldn't refuse it, I was told that now I have to do a commercial for you guys. So, Boston butts, they're roughly about 10 pounds. Be $45. We're going to do them on the 28th of May, and you'll pick them up that Saturday morning, which will be the 29th. That's Memorial Day weekend. So you'll have barbecue for the weekend, and you don't have to go to the restaurants and pay $13 a pound for barbecue, because if you do the numbers, you can get a Boston butt for roughly around 10 pounds. We will shred it for you, so it looks like it's pulled pork when we get done with it. You come in, you pick out your one that's sitting on the table. We'll take that one, we'll put it in the pot. You stand right there, we'll shred it up for you. It's now all ready to eat. We then put it in a pan, you take it home. Now, this is where the catch comes in. Everybody says, well, we just have a few at our house, there's only two of us or whatever. And my comment to that is well, you can go out to a restaurant and pay $13 a pound for it, or you can pay $45 and get 10 pounds. Do the math on that one. 10 pounds at 13, that's $130 you'd be paying. So then you take that meat and you get Ziploc bags and you portion it out and you stick it in the freezer. So in 3 weeks from now, when you want barbecue again, you just pull out a bag, you warm it up, and you got fresh barbecue, okay? So it's very simple and it's very good, and we need you to buy one from us because this will be a good fundraiser for the men's club this year. So you can buy them by getting a hold of one of the men in the men's club, me, Carl, Jack, Mark, Harold, Bruce, Bill, you know, just about any man in here, most of the guys are in the men's club. So, you know, it's $45, and there's a actually pink flyer that's...
It's in the newsletter.
It's in the newsletter? Okay. All right. But you can fill that out and turn the money into the office also. But anyway, we just want to let y'all know we've not done a Boston Butt for been a good while for a church fundraiser. So this would be a good way to get some barbecue for Memorial Day weekend and help the men's club. Thank you.
Thank you, Burrell. Thank you, Burrell. Now, it's not in your bulletin this month, today, Sunday, but next Sunday, this little flyer here will be in there, so you can sign it up, drop it in the thing, or tell some of those folks, or just give me $45. That'll work. I need $45. Okay, we've done the birthdays, we've done the anniversaries, and we've done the Boston Butts. And that is good barbecue. I was sort of surprised the first time I got it, and they said, "Do you want it chopped up?" And they was over there, had the thing chopping it up. I said, "Yeah, go ahead and chop it up." And so he did, and man, it was just great, you know. And so anyhow, we need some volunteers for this preschool director. Actually, we need a couple of volunteers. So if you can volunteer, look in your bulletin there. And I see where you can volunteer. Of course, we're having a Thursday is the National Day of Prayer. You'll notice that is Thursday. Monday is the coffee, and Wednesdays we're doing the Bible Zoom, and it's going well. And I've actually figured out how to get it on my iPad and see everybody, so that works well. The Zooming, and it's not very difficult to do because I can do it, so it must not be very difficult to do. And there was a few more other things. He gave me a whole list of things, and I knew I'd forget half of them. But the upper rooms are ready, so don't forget to get your upper rooms. They are here in the vestibule, so do your upper rooms and the Bible study, the Zoom, and also here at the church is on Corinthians, and we're into chapter 4 on 1 Corinthians. And I'm sure I forgot some other things, Pastor, so that's about all I can remember right now. Okay? Thank you very much.
And if you'll remain seated and sing with us, Sweet Hour of Prayer.
My Father's throne, may God.
we go to the Lord in prayer, I invite you to think about a part of your life in which you especially could use the hand of God, and offer that up in the moment of silent prayer, not just for yourself, but think about somebody near and dear to you and how you would pray for them. And when we go to the Lord in silent prayer, I invite you to pray for them too. I was talking to a friend of mine from a Methodist pastor from the Florida Annual Conference, and he said he was concerned that so often in church we go through our order of worship, our ritual, and he's not against that, but he says we get so much in routine that it seems as if it's by rote and not by heart, his words. And I don't think that's necessarily true, but I just think we want to emphasize that we're not here for routine's sake, but we're here to meet the Lord and to offer our worship and our prayers unto God. And so let's be as real as we can. Let's bow our heads and we'll begin our prayer time with a moment of silent prayer. Heavenly Father, you hear the yearnings of our heart, and the cries of our souls, and we lift our concerns unto you and our prayer concerns for those who are near and dear to us. Dear Lord, as we lift them up, we pray that we might experience healing and guidance and miracles and your strength in the areas of our life which we have lifted up for ourselves. And Heavenly Father, we pray for those whom we've named silently in our hearts, that they too might even now experience your grace and your love, your peace and your healing and the wholeness that comes from you. We know, Lord, that you are our joy and our peace and our health and our strength. They come from you. Gracious Lord, we lift up our prayers from our community and our nation. We pray for the leaders and those who are in authority, that they might use their positions for good. We pray for leaders in the church and for your churches here and abroad, that they might boldly proclaim your truth and boldly worship you, and that we might be a force for good as individual congregations and as churches united, that we might be a force for good for the world. And dear Lord, we pray for your ministry here at Burns Methodist. We're thankful, Lord, for our church and our legacy and our history here, all that we have been blessed with. And we pray that moving forward, you might continue to guide us so that we might better and more fully love you with heart and soul and mind and strength, and so that we might better and more fully love our neighbors as ourselves. Guide us and shape us as your people. We pray this in your name. And together we pray as you taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Announcement, very important one, and it's not in your bulletin. Pastor John has been appointed to be with us another year. So Thank you for that.
Appreciate you making the announcement, Harold. We are so thankful the word came from the bishop that I'm expected to be reappointed, and I'm happy and hope to finish my tenure as a Methodist preacher here in, you know, another 20 years. So we're thankful to be back. That we're too formal here at Burns. And they said they don't feel free to say amen. I know Brother Bill does, but they don't feel generally free to say amen or hallelujah like they want to. So, you know, I think we should probably practice.
Amen.
Amen. So on three, everybody let's say amen together. One, two, three. Amen. Now, Bill can make that much sound all by himself. We can do better. On three again. One, two, three. Amen. All right, now sometimes we're going to do a variation and say hallelujah. You ever heard that in church? Hallelujah. All right, let's do that on three. One, two, three. Hallelujah. All right, so if the Spirit moves you, don't feel like we're too formal. You know, you can let it rip. You don't have to go to a Pentecostal church to feel free to yell out. You know, we can do that here. We can. You know, even if we, you know, might be a little more uptight than some people, we can still let it, you know, say amen and call out our praise. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Hallelujah. You know, when he says it, we probably ought to all echo it. That'd be a good way to get it going. Our scripture today is from the book of Psalms. Let me get the right quote here, Psalms verses 11 and 12. Let's stand, please, for the reading of God's word. And the text for the New King James Version is in the bulletin. Give us help from trouble, for the help of man is useless. Through God we will do valiantly, for it is he who shall tread down our enemies. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. That's going to be fun. I like the word valiant. This has been always one of my favorite verses, Psalm 60, verses 11 and 12, because it uses that phrase, through God we will do valiantly. Psalm 108 has the same phrase, so it could be either text this morning, but I love that. I love that phrase. The word valiant, according to Merriam-Webster's dictionary, is someone possessing or acting with bravery or boldness or courage. I like to think that God's people are secret. I wish I had a little special shirt on here. Secret knights, like we are heroes or Superman or Superwomen, that through God we can do valiant things, valiant deeds. The Hebrew word, by the way, translated valiant, is used 243 times in the Old Testament. Almost, more than half, anyway, of those times, it refers to warriors. It refers to battle groupings, military units. But there are a good many times where valiant behavior is referring to other kinds of behavior. For instance, Boaz, when speaking to Ruth, he uses this phrase to her. Now, it's translated usually different, but one of the translators uses that same word, valiant. Boaz saying, your character, your strength come through. You are valiant, and I can tell that you are a worthy woman, is how the NIV, I think, translates it when Boaz is talking to Ruth. But it's that same Hebrew word, a valiant person for leaving her home and coming to Bethlehem with her mother-in-law and providing for her mother-in-law and for herself and reaching out with courage to approach Boaz the way she does. She takes courage, if you remember her story, courage to do what she did. Through God, we'll do valiantly, the psalmist says. Valiant ought to be one word that describes us as God's people. I'd like to focus for a few minutes on two of these words, do and through. The first has to do with attitude, do, and the second has to do with means, through. Christians are meant to be doers, not just hearers of the word, but doers of the word, as James wrote, people of action, not hiding out, but active in the world, making the world a better place, because we are here individually and we are here as a community. Biblical archaeologist Ray Vanderlyn has a series of videos that we've used in studies before. In one of the episodes, he takes us to Caesarea Philippi. It's a great series, by the way. He actually takes a camera crew to these different locations that talks about different events from the Bible that happens at these different locations. Caesarea Philippi, as you can see on the map, is about 25 miles northeast or so from Galilee, up above where Jesus and his disciples normally gathered, way up even past where Jewish people normally resided in that day and time. This is in the area of what's called the Golan Heights today. Dan occupied it, the tribe of Dan, in the Old Testament, and it became a center of paganism in the Old Testament. The Greeks conquered it, and they built idols up there, idols to their god Pan, the half-goat, half-man, and so it was a fertility site. It was called Panus, and then it became known as Banias. And then when Herod the Great's son Philip was given rulership of the area, he built a city there and named it Caesarea Philippi after Caesar, Caesar who had given him the authority to be there. It's a fertile, a beautiful place on this southern slope of Mount Hermon. Mount Hermon about 9,000 feet up, so it's a beautiful environment. In this site, there are temples and temples and temples to pagan deities. And this is the strange place that Jesus brought his disciples to in Matthew chapter 16, where he asked that key question of the Gospel of Matthew. He says, who do men say that the Son of Man is? And the disciples say, you are John the Baptist or Elijah or some other prophet raised from the dead. But then Jesus says, and here's the question of the gospel. He says, who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter answers and says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, Simon son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. For years and years, people have wondered, what is this rock that we are building the church on that the gates of hell cannot prevail against? The Catholics would say that the rock is Peter, that you are Peter, and it's because Peter, the word Peter means rock. And so they said that because Jesus is using you are Peter, and on this rock, that he's obviously talking about Peter being the rock, as if his name is Rocky, as in Rocky Balboa. And he says, you are rock, and on rock, I'm going to build my church. And so the church is based on the authority and legacy of the Apostle Simon Peter. The Protestants have traditionally said that it's not based on the man Peter, but the church is built on the Peter-like faith, rock-like faith, the faith that asserts that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that we'll do anything to be his disciples. Ray Vanderlyn, when he took his film crew there, he proposed about 25 years ago when he made the films a different view, which has become very popular in the last couple decades because it could well be true. And that is not simply about Peter and not simply about Peter's faith, but it could be that the rock is in fact Caesarea Philippi, and Jesus is saying that we're going to build the church even in pagan places like this. When Jesus uses the word Peter in this passage, it's the word Petros in Greek. P-E-T-R-O-S would be the transliteration. And then when he refers to on this rock, he's using the word Petra. And so there's a difference. Petros is in the masculine sense and is used as a name. Petra is in the neuter sense, and is used in terms of things. And so Ray Vanderlyn said that this is one indication that he's not talking about Peter there. He's talking about the location. But he's also, Ray brings up this other interesting point. There's a section there of that wall that has a huge, huge, huge cave in it. And there used to be a spring that would pour water out of this cave mouth. And the Pharisees wrote about this cave mouth as if it was the gates of hell. They would do pagan rituals down there. Now there's been an earthquake, and the spring doesn't come directly from there anymore. It comes from rocks around the base of that cliff. But it used to come right out of that mouth of the cave, the spring. And so Ray is saying, when Jesus says, the gates of hell, I'm going to build my church, that I'm going to build it even in pagan places like this. And when you think about gates in a city, the gates are what guard the city. And so if the gates of hell aren't going to stand, then who's on the attack and who's on the defense? Friends, the church is on the attack. No matter how you translate the Peter part, if the gates aren't going to stand against the church, then the church is being assertive. The church is being aggressive. The church is pushing its values out into the world, and the gates of Hades are not standing against it. So I think my translation of Jesus' words would be something like this. You are Peter, a rock. And even in pagan places, as evil as this rock and hill of paganism, the church will come, and evil will not be able to withstand it. Amen? Through God, the psalmist says, through God we're going to do valiantly. The church is called to be assertive and courageous, valiant, and follow. You ever wonder where we would be if Christians had not been valiant, if God's people had not been valiant in the past? What if David the shepherd boy had seen the size of Goliath when he came to visit his brothers at the front, bringing food from his father Jesse for his brothers and the soldiers? What if David looked at the size of Goliath and dropped off the food and said, bye, you all got this, you're soldiers, I'm going to go back to watching sheep. What if David had not been valiant? What if Esther, the queen, had And when she found out about Haman's plot to destroy the Jews and knew it was dangerous for her to intervene, had said to her uncle Mordecai, I'm sure God has a better plan than me intervening. You all have this. I'm not going to risk it. I've got to look after myself, you know. What if Paul and Silas, who were beaten as they traveled and arrested and beaten and spent a night in prison after being flogged, if Paul and Silas had looked at each other and said, you know, enough of this apostle stuff. We're going to go back. Let's go back home. Let's go back to the church. They don't want us here anyway. What if Ruth, instead of helping her stepmother Naomi, said, Mother, I'm sorry you've had so much bad luck. Have a good trip home to Bethlehem. Maybe life will pick up for you there. What if God's people had not been assertive, had not been valiant? Friends, we're called to bring God's values with courage, with assertiveness into the world. True story, when Charles Dickens was writing the story about orphans, Oliver Twist, when he was writing his, it was originally published as a series in a magazine, parts of the story. But as Oliver Twist was publishing that, George and his wife, Mary Mueller, were starting orphanages to care for the same kinds of kids that Charles Dickens was writing about. George, Reverend George and Mary Mueller, saw their God-given mission as providing hospitality and homes to orphan children. And as their mission grew, as they first designated part of their home, and then they bought another home and hired caregivers for that one, and they bought another place. And as this effort grew, he grew to have many homes. I thought I had it written down here, but he gave care to 10,000 children in his lifetime. And it's still in operation, these orphanages. They're called the Ashley Down Orphanages, or simply the Mueller Homes in England. Established 117 schools. He is famous not just for establishing the orphanages, not just for being valiant in stepping up and seeing the need, the poor kids who are on the street, and providing homes for them. He's famous not just for doing that, but for never asking for any help. I mean, any help in terms of money, any help in terms of food for the kids. He said, we're going to pray in the help. And as they would faithfully pray, someone would bring homemade bread or a shipment of milk. The cart would have broken down, and they'd say, could you use some milk? And people would bring in food. And as they needed money to pay to buy the coal to heat the houses, money would come in. He's famous for making his orphanages, not his orphanages, but God's orphanages, and seeing his ministry as a partnership with God. Friends, we're called to do valiant things, but not with our own strength. We're called to do valiant things through the strength of God, through relying on God, through God working within us. There's a great story in the Old Testament book of Judges about a man named Samson. Anyone ever heard of Samson before? There's a picture of Mueller with the kids. See what the next picture is. There's Samson. Samson, amazing strength. I think the Greek story about Hercules is probably based off of Samson. Amazing strength. And one time he was locked in a city gate, and they closed the gates, and he picked up the gates and walked away with them and carried the city gates to a hilltop miles and miles away. Another time they had captured him and tied him up with ropes, and he just snapped the ropes. And the Bible says it's as if they were wheat that was on fire. It just snapped like it was nothing. Amazing feats of strength and war skill. Surrounded by thousands of Philistines, he picked up the jawbone of a donkey and hit him back and forth until thousands of Philistines were dead and many more fled. But you know, in the story and all the film and all the art, you always have Samson looking like that, some kind of giant with big muscles. You know, he probably looked a lot more like that. He's probably an average guy with average physique, because the Bible said the Philistines didn't get it. They couldn't understand where all this power came from. But the power came from God's Spirit, didn't it? Amen? The Spirit of God gave him the power. He was able to do valiant things through God working within him. Our text today, through God we would do valiantly. Not through our own strength, lest we boast. Not through the strength of others, as much as it's important for us to work together. But it's through the Lord's blessing that we have the courage and the boldness and the stamina to be valiant and do great things for God. Paul wrote, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. God working on the inside, making us stronger, more courageous, better people. Assertive following Jesus. Let me just sum it up here, and then we'll have Holy Communion together. We often, when we think about confession, in the beginning ritual of communion, there's the words of confession. We often think about things which we have done, called sins of commission. But you know, there are also things which we should have done. They're called sins of omission, things which we should have done but did not do. The good that could come out of our lives, had we got in the game, had we got off the sidelines. Friends, our part, as if we're a missing part of a puzzle, our part is to use our gifts and our talents the way God would have us to do it. And when we hold back out of fear and out of lack of confidence, friends, we need to realize that everybody's afraid and everybody struggles with confidence. We need to breathe deep, to trust more in the power of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit working within, and press on and move forward and do good things, because that's what God wants us to do. Through your faith in God, be bold. Through your faith in God, be courageous. Through your faith in God, be strong. Through your faith in God, be valiant. Do great things to God's glory, for His glory, and for His honor. Amen. Hallelujah.
We got it. Now, if you don't mind, would you please stand as we sing Only Trust Him.
While we were yet sinners, that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Amen.
And let's join together in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and worship.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by your blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
For those who are assisting and directing the service, would you please come forward this time?
our pastor was saying that sometimes, you know, the amen and the hallelujah, you know, some of us are also used to the word glory. So if you hear me holler glory, you know it. All right. Now as we sing our closing hymn, would you please stand as we sing Standing on the Promises.
The benediction. Go forth in peace, and the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
Amen.